Okay, good morning, everybody. I'd just like to welcome you all to the FCC Theatre this morning. Just a quick reminder, if you're collecting the CEU credits, the sign-up sheets are at the back, and just to turn your cell phones off if you can do that, please. So this morning I would like to welcome David Mielke here. David is a senior analyst with Oil World. He is a market analyst actively involved in global supply and demand projections at ISTA Mielke GmbH, Oil World in Hamburg, Germany, a leading research organization that provides global support, demand, price analysis, statistics and forecasts for all the major oil seeds, vegetable oils, animal fats and oil meals, as well as biodiesel and other products. He joined the Oil World team in 2013 after studying economics with a focus on international trade and game theory. Prior to his current role, he spent a year in the US and worked in various agriculture firms in Switzerland and Southeast Asia. Welcome, David.
Thank you.
Are you on or?
Pardon?
Am I on or no?
I don't know. Are you on?
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to be here today in Canada. The topic of my presentation, global oil supply demand and price outlook. The question you are all going to ask yourself is, why do we have to talk about prices of vegetable oils? I hope after the presentation it becomes clear how dependent also Canadian oilseed prices are and how dependent they are of the vegetable oils prices in the world. The market is becoming very complex, not only for oilseeds, but also for vegetable oils, oil meals, and all other agricultural products. During the last 12 months, we had a lot of risk factors and uncertainties, and this is going to continue to determine price making also in 2019. I'm here for you guys today, so if you have questions or if you don't understand something I'm saying, please raise your hand or just talk, and we can also discuss your question during my presentation, but also in the end you will have some time to ask questions. Let me start with two slides here that summarize my agenda today. The first one is monthly prices of rapeseed oil, which is the European word for canola, and palm oil in Europe. I brought you a slide from 74 until today. And you can see clearly palm oil is the price leader globally when it comes to vegetable oils because of its dominance in quantity. And rapeseed or canola oil is following at a distance, and especially today we have a quite widespread, unusually widespread between rapeseed oil and palm oil. And during my presentation I will try to explain to you why that is and what we will expect for the next 12 months. The second slide I have is future prices, and I show European rapeseed futures on the Matif and canola futures in Winnipeg. I put them both in US dollars in order to make them a little bit more comparable. What we can see here is quite a widespread between the two prices. European prices quite stable, trading in a very narrow range, and canola prices declining, recovered a little bit. And the second big topic is, why is that? What has influenced the Canadian canola prices? Which were the bearish factors that led to this decline, while European prices stayed relatively firm? In the end of the day, you don't really want to know what the numbers will look like, but we want to know what does that do to our prices. Theoretically, it's very easy. We have supply and demand, and that should, in the end, result in an equilibrium price in an ideal market. But we don't have an ideal market. Especially 2018 is a perfect year in which we can see all the different factors that influence our prices. We have governments. We're not only talking about the neighboring country in the south and the new administration. We also have government intervention in China, the Chinese and US trade war is going to be part of the presentation. But we also have intervention in Southeast Asia, in India. Weather is a problem, will still be a problem and uncertainty that we kind of have to hedge. And of course, media, financial markets are all playing a part. Really briefly, I don't know how many of you watched the presentation in the morning. We were talking about a Twitter picture and the difficulty you face when you find information on the markets online. We are doing this for 60 years and we are independent. So if I tell you something about prices, I might be wrong, I might be right, but I'm not influenced by my position. In our days, we have the problem that a lot of people that give price forecasts are either related to banks or part of big corporations, which for you as a farmer always makes it a little bit difficult to really understand the meaning of the price forecast, whether this is the actual forecast or whether this should help the position. So we're doing this. We are looking at statistics. We're looking at it monthly. You cannot only look at it seasonally or annually. You have to look at it by months to see the changes within the season and to make price forecasts or to derive implications for our markets. So I'm in Canada. I cannot show this slide to you in Europe because everybody's very upset when they see it. Tremendous achievement, yeah, I have to say. I was here in Saskatchewan 10 years ago, and they were proclaiming 20 million by 2020. We reached that level already before this goal. So, tremendous achievement, and what is most interesting is here, production very much skyrocketing, area increasing, but marginally, or just trending sideways. Most of the increase came out of yields, came out of productivity growth, which partly is related to better seeding material, but also to a larger extent to you as a farmer who achieved better yields. The question is, where are we going from last year? Are we going to go to 22 million? Are we going to go to 25 million? The area, in my point of view, is very limited. We have not a lot of additional area in high productive states in order to increase the area. So if we want to increase our production, and in the end of the presentation, you will see the world market will need even more canola in 3, 4, 5, and 10 years. We have to work on further productivity growth, further yield increases. I don't want to show you too many numbers. I like numbers, but that sometimes gets a little bit confusing, so I will try to concentrate on charts. Still, and I'm not a Canadian, but still I want to show you our estimates for the Canadian canola balance, and you see tremendous growth in production, and on the graph, that's disposals, so exports and crushings. What is important and what is a risk and an uncertainty you have to live with it is that if we just look at seed, 50% of the canola we produce in Canada or you guys produce in Canada is exported. But that's important to understand, the crush of around 9 to 10 million tons of canola, 75 to 80% of the canola oil is also exported, and 85 to 90% of the meal. That means that out of the 9.2, 9.4 million tons of crush, roughly 80 to 85% is only crushed because we have the market abroad to buy our canola oil and meal. And that's why we have to look also at what is happening in the oils and fats markets worldwide and the protein markets. That's the total production for, and that's why the people in Europe don't like me to show the Canadian slide, because worldwide canola production, rapeseed and canola production is declining, harvesting area moving sideways. We only have two growth markets, Canada, of course, the biggest, and Ukraine and Russia and other CIS countries, so former Soviet Union countries. Everything else, Europe declining, I'll show a slide later. China, nightmare, yeah, it's a mess. Don't believe the official Chinese numbers. I've been to China in November, I talked to the government in China. They show numbers that are more than double the number we have. They work with more than 11 million tons, forget it. Yeah, it's just not there. Production declining, further decline expected. India, also a problem. So the world demand for canola can only be satisfied by Canada and Ukraine and Russia. So what I just said, I have it here on a slide. You see, for the first time in, I think, 35 or 40 years, I'm not quite sure, but around that, Canada is outpacing the EU in terms of production growth, yeah, and in terms of actual production. So Canada is the violet line or the purple line. 18-19 will be above the European Union, and that's our current estimate for the European Union, yeah. We expect another significant downward correction in the EU, probably. At the moment, we have 800,000 tons. That's an optimistic number. We might come to 1 to 1.2 million tons that we are missing in Europe. And that's the chart. I had a meeting with the German government, and we discussed future potential for the agriculture. And I showed them this slide and said, look at this. We have Germany or the EU declining yield trends, and Ukraine and Canada increases. Yeah, in Canada, the increase is coming. Unfortunately, I would say it's only the farmers, but a large part of it is also better seeding, better planting material related to GM modification, which is not available in Europe, and it's not likely that the European Union is starting to allow GMO planting material for rapeseed in Europe. So you see Germany especially declining, partly weather-related, but also related to new legislation on treatment of the seeds. It's a big debate, it's a big environmentally driven debate, and it's not looking like they can do the turnaround anytime soon. The European rapeseed supply and demand balance, why do I show this? By far the biggest rapeseed crusher and one of the biggest consumers of, or the biggest consumer of rapeseed oil. Yeah, crushings down this year. Probably we will see another decline next year. So the situation for rapeseed in Europe is critical, partly weather-related, and that's why, when you remember, or if you remember the slide in the beginning, the European prices were relatively firm compared to the bearish price movement we saw in Winnipeg. So the very tight supply outlook in Europe is supporting European prices. Stocks in Europe probably down half a million ton to 600,000 tons. Imports record this year so far, and crushings down also 500,000, 600,000 tons. Here the European yields on the bottom, you can see the trend yield. I might have to explain. It's a trend yield basis at 2013. I did that because that was the time before the EU changed regulations on seed treatment and seed manufacturing. So you see, we are significant below the trend line, and even with our optimistic yield scenario for 2019, we are going to stay below the multi-year average trend line. Just another way of looking at it, European crushings down, European rapeseed balance, high imports. The question is, how can we as Canadian canola farmers and the canola industry, how can we raise or how can we take advantage or how can we profit from the current EU situation and the outlook? Out of the 4.2 million tons of imports, you can see only 400,000 to 500,000 tons out of Canada. The question is why? Why can we not increase our market share in Europe? Why can we not create a market for Canadian canola in Europe? The answer is European producers need sustainable, certified canola seed in order to use the canola oil or the rapeseed oil for biodiesel production. Yeah, within the mandate. So this is limiting Canadian canola exports, even at very attractive prices, which we all have to understand. We are the most competitive in terms of prices here in Canada, but still, political decisions are curbing our potential or limiting our potential to export to the European Union. The question is, are we as Canadians, do we want to try to enter the market? Are we going to push for sustainable seeds to enter that market? Or do we say, hey, we have more potential, but we concentrate on countries like China, like UAE, Pakistan, so United Arab Emirates, in order to dispose of our production that we cannot use domestically? That's a question I cannot answer. We have seen in the trade war between China and the US that depending heavily, and Canada is heavily depending on China. I'm not saying it's bad. I'm not saying the Chinese have bad intentions. It's just something we have to consider, that we are highly depending on Chinese import demand here in Canada, not only for canola seed, also for the oil and also for the meal. Record so far this year, very good. But the question is, how are we going to tackle that issue in the future? What you have seen in the slides before in the canola balance, you can see here clearly on European prices. Palm oil price is very low, again, the price leader. Sun oil, soya oil following this bearish trend, and rape oil relatively stable. Unusually wide premiums, yeah, and this is not sustainable, and this is going to change in the coming months. So outlook, global outlook for oil seeds. You can see here canola is important in Canada, worldwide. All other nine oil seeds, which also includes flax, cotton, groundnuts, palm kernel seeds, so nine other oil seeds, very flat, record production growth in soybeans, and that production growth is only taking place in US, South America, primarily Argentina, the growth in Brazil, but Argentina, Paraguay, Bolivia, Uruguay. In the past 30 years, world soybean imports doubled every 10 years, tremendous. Driven, as we saw it before in the presentation prior to mine, demand for proteins worldwide is increasing. Proteins, soybean, a meal seed. And here in Canada, we have canola. We call it an oil seed because the oil share is quite double the oil share of soybeans. And for Canadian canola, it's always good if we see an increase in the oil share prices. So if the oil price relative to meal and the seed price is increasing, then we're talking about an increasing oil share price. So we expect that with the uptrend in palm, I'm going to talk about it now, canola is going to profit because we are expecting an increase of the oil share. Whereas the last 12 months were mainly driven by the bearish sentiment in soybeans and meal seed. Yeah, imports of soybeans, the trade war between China and the US, I mentioned it before, that has really changed the momentum in our markets or in the agricultural markets in the last 12 months. Or it started in May, but still the second half of the season. China is going to reduce imports of soybeans for the first time ever, just because normally they import around, or they imported 92 million tons, but out of that normally half or 40% was US beans. With 25% import duties on US beans and the de facto import ban by the Chinese government. So we had a situation where South American soybean prices were at a premium to the US that was larger than the US prices plus the 25% duty. Still, nobody imported US soybeans, which tremendously affected the US soybean balance and has impacts on global trade flows. Now, which is very interesting, is cheap US soybean prices. We could ask ourselves, why is that important for me as a Canadian farmer who produces canola? Well, the problem is that if US soybean prices are at multi-year lows, countries that can shift their crush capacity to soybeans, which are attractively priced in the US, are at the same time reducing the imports of canola, mainly from Canada. We saw this in Mexico, we saw this in Pakistan, Bangladesh, and United Arab Emirates. Slightly different story there because of Indian import demands for rape oil, but still, all other major importing countries except China have reduced imports of Canadian canola since July, and that you can see also in the monthly exports of Canada. Sorry. So impacts of the trade war, we don't have to go into much detail. Soybean crushings in China are going to go down. You see, I mean, look at the growth line. Compared to all other countries in the world, China is the major player in the market, and China is heavily influencing prices. This is important. That's why I also put it down in a table, and also in the end, I show my email address. If you need the presentation, I am happy to share it with you, so you don't have to write down numbers. Really easy for me to send it to you guys. That's the other impact of the trade war between the US and China. Imports of vegetable oils are going to reach a record level, according to our estimates. And out of those 9.7 million tons or 9.8 million tons, rapeseed oil, 1.3 million tons, most of that coming from Canada, which we remember from the beginning, higher import demand globally for rapeseed or canola oil is raising crush margins domestically here in Canada, which enables us as a producer to achieve a better price in the domestic market for processing of canola. Similar in the imports of 8 oil meals. You see here, rapeseed meal, again, sorry for that. We use the European term, but that's the same as canola meal. 1.5 million tons. Also here, most of that coming from Canada. We have already seen that until December, large increases, and this is going to continue, at least in our opinion. Hardly any soya meal so far. This is mainly related to the fact that the Chinese cannot import Argentine meal. Argentina is the biggest exporter of soya meal. Again, it's a technical, political thing. Also, Indian soya meal cannot go to China. So there's basically no other store in town for them to cover their protein requirements. So we're expecting an increase in imports of rapeseed meal. Quickly, soybeans outlook. At the moment, we expect production to increase by 19, 20 million tons. But this may be overestimated because we already lost 6 million tons of soybeans in South America. It has been too wet in northern Argentina and at the same time too dry in central Brazil, which happens every once in a while, that the two countries that are very close together have an uneven distribution of rainfall. So we have too much rainfall either in Argentina or northern Argentina or southern Brazil, and at the same time dryness in central Brazil, or we have it vice versa. So that is impacting our markets. That's why our current estimates here might be a little bit on the upside, on the high side. Still, situation in soybeans is bearish. Soybean exports, I don't think we need to go into too much detail here. Just really briefly, then that's what I mentioned before. We see here in September, August, we see large increases also. We see large increases also here in Canadian exports of soybeans. I didn't talk about Canadian production of soybeans. I know it's very important also here in Manitoba. We saw good increases, but Canada profited and will continue to profit from the current Chinese-U.S. trade conflict. We ran out of soybeans in Brazil and Argentina, so China went everywhere else to buy the soybeans, which we profited from here in Canada. And we expect Canadian exports around 6 million tons this year. Large part of that China, Europe, of course, also, but this is helping also Canadian exports of soybeans. You can see here, U.S. exports, we expect an increase in January, August, just because the South American stocks are so low, especially in Brazil, that some of the import demand from other countries will, you know, increase from the U.S., but still, total U.S. exports will be down by at least 8 million tons, probably an optimistic scenario. And that's why we saw, in our opinion, such a bearish price trend also in Winnipeg, influenced by the U.S. CBOT soybean prices. We expect at the moment ending stocks in the U.S. 26.5 or 27 million tons. Chinese imports that were discussed during the trade negotiations of 3.5 million tons in recent weeks are not enough to change the situation. Even if they import 5, 6, or 10 million tons of U.S. beans, we still have 27, maybe 28 million tons of U.S. soybean ending stocks compared to 12 million tons before, and they will have a difficult time to find a market for the U.S. beans. The only way they can dispose of it is attractive prices, which might lead to more countries shifting more of their crush capacity to U.S. beans, in turn reducing imports of rapeseed and canola. Mexico is a good example. They're increasing rapidly. They're profiting. They're one of the big profiters from, or one of the big beneficiaries of the current trade conflict. But this is something we have to keep in mind. How is the U.S. reacting to this situation? And What are the impacts for us here in Canada? So, I talked about this before. Record US stocks, you see that here in the red line. Let's see whether this works. Yeah. You see this here, 28 million tons. Total world soybean stocks, probably 103, 104 million tons. This is clearly bearish. Yeah. This is bearish for oil seeds, and this is bearish for oil meals. However, and we talk about vegetable oils now, the situation for Canadian canola might be different or is likely to be different from the situation for US soybeans. Sunflower seed, just briefly, a big increase, mainly Ukraine, Russia. It's a factor, but it's something we have to keep in mind, but is not the major influencing factor for us here in Canada. Soya meal usage down. That's the other bearish aspect of the, on the one hand, large supplies of soybeans, yeah, and on the other hand, a likely decline in Chinese soya meal consumption, which is partly related to political incentives to reduce soya meal in feed ratios, and the other factor is the outbreak of the swine fever, which is influencing feed demand in China. You can also see this in Chinese prices. Chinese soybean prices, despite the import problem from the US and the import taxes, Chinese soybean prices since May have declined. It's a May position, but also since May have declined. And also soya meal is on a downtrend, which is a clear sign, in, at least in our opinion, for weak Chinese demand for soybean meal, and this is making the situation for soybeans even more bearish. World disappearance is usage. I like to look at relative changes year on year. You can see tremendous growth rates in the last 5 years. This season, sharply below average, and this is having an impact on prices. This is an important price-making factor, exactly. Now, let's talk about vegetable oils. We're running a little bit short on time here, but I like this chart. It's the 16-year change, yeah? And that's why we need also to look at not only U.S. soybeans as a Canadian canola producer. We also have to look at vegetable oils. And vegetable oils, you can see the blue... you can see the blue piece of the pie. It was only 16% of world production, palm oil, in 1992, 1993. Now we are up to 32%. This percentage share is going to rise. This is why palm oil is now in the vegetable oil markets the big elephant in the room, determining price developments, and most other vegetable oils follow palm oil, at least at a distance. You can see here, in addition to the bearish soybean situation, we also had a bearish price environment in palm oil. Palm oil prices in, this is daily here, FOB Argentina and FOB Indonesia for palm oil, prices plummeted to the lowest level here. Prices fell to 12-year low, $430 per ton in Indonesia, because production recovered sharply and world demand was lower than expected, especially from India and other major importing countries, leaving the world with record supplies and record stocks of palm oil. However, this is changing now, and we already... yesterday, palm oil traded at 5.35 already. So we are up $100 from the lows we've seen in early December. Briefly, even more astonishing than the growth we've seen in Canadian canola, world palm oil production increased from close to 10 million tons in 1990 to more than 70, 72, 73 million tons last year. Yeah. You see El Nino effects, the blue circle is a little bit wrong here. It should be exactly here. You see the El Nino effect. Price, the increase, we only saw two declines in world palm oil production since 84, 85, yeah? And that was related El Nino, weather impacts, price effects. And what is important to understand is this increase here was partly related to the sharp decline the year before. Palms recovered, and the recovery, palms are tending to overcompensate declines in the previous year. So quite an interesting development. This is not going to continue. Environmental issues, labor issues are going to cap or limit the further growth, which in the years ahead will create new marketing opportunities for Canadian canola oil. Yeah, big challenges. Lack of replanting, labor shortage, below potential yields, acreage limitations. This is going to influence prices. Because in palm, it's not like oilseeds. In oilseeds, you can look at this year. Next year, you plant something different. We always say in palm, and I don't want to be offensive, but in palm, we always say, palm is like getting married. You have the tree for at least 20 years. Yeah. Otherwise, it's very expensive. So you need to plant a tree. It's very expensive to plant it. And then you produce after 4 years or 3.5 years, and then you keep the tree for at least 20 years. So production changes are not as easy as they are in oilseeds, grains, or other agricultural products. World production of four major oils. Briefly, you see the red line, palm oil, El Nino, 15-16, sharp decline, 4 million tons. All other years, palm oil is the growth leader in world production growth to satisfy world demand. And this growth is going to slow down, and it's going to slow down further, creating new opportunities for other vegetable oils. Something else we have to consider is, at the moment, we like to look at production, it's the blue line, and supplies, which means opening stocks and production. Yeah, this is something you have to understand. It's important to consider stock changes. So you have record stocks, a slowdown in production, but still the supply slowdown is not as big as the drop in production. I wrote it down here. So Indonesia, Malaysia is going to slow down. World output maybe rises only by around 3 million tons. However, and that's important to understand, is supplies are still rising, but the red line, demand, is skyrocketing. Yeah? So why is that? Why do we see suddenly an increase in demand?